Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you all for coming. Can I get a roll call?
Mr. Burns?
Here.
Mr. Cook?
Here.
Mr. Rogan?
Here.
Mr. Williams?
Here. Somebody like to make a motion on the reports?
I'll make a motion to the town board accept the reports as noted on the agenda for January 11, 2017. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. I'll make a motion that the town board approve the supervisor's reports for November 2016. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
On the minutes, I will make a motion. There's quite a few of them, so we're going to do them. Two batches, I think. Make a motion that we approve the bid opening minutes for the ambulance of December 13th, 2016, the town board meeting minutes of October 26th, November 16th, and November 30th, 2016. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. And also a motion to approve the town board meeting minutes of December 14th, 2016, and the organizational meeting for January 4th, 2017. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Can I get an audit of the bills?
I will make a motion that the town board approve abstract number 24, dated December 30th, 2016, in the amount of $179,316.13. So moved.
All in favor?
Second.
Sorry. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Mr. Cook.
Uh-huh. Okay. First, we received a letter from Matt Chabarro relative to a junior staff member. Somehow this young man didn't get his increase like he should have for January 1st, 2017.
Just so you know, he was hired in the middle of our doing the budget, so he didn't make the salary schedule.
Okay. So I'll make a motion that the town board approve Connor Light at the pay rate of $9 per hour for 2017. So moved.
Second.
Is that retro to the beginning?
Retro to January 1st.
January 1st.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next is the clock repairs for town hall here. Received a letter from our maintenance guy, Dennis Mays, and the clock tower needed to be fixed. The motor on the clock, one of the motors on the clock was no longer serviceable. It had to be replaced. Full inspection was done on all three clocks and preventive maintenance was performed. This all cost $1,035. So I'll make a motion the town board approve the payment of $1,035 to Verdon Company. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Next is the shelter contract for stray animals, dogs that are picked up by our dog control officers. And it looks like we have two agreements. One with Brook Farm, where dogs are first brought, and then the Putnam County Humane Society as our backup shelter. So I will make a motion that the town board approve the contract or the agreement with Brook Farm Veterinary Center.
You're introducing the resolution approving the agreement?
Yes. So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. And I'm doing the same thing with the second one relating to the Putnam County Humane Society. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
So we renewed both of them. They're both the same as what we did last year.
Yes. Yeah. I've been working with both Brook Farms as our primary shelter where we keep the dogs for a period of 5 days and Putnam Humane, and the contracts, essentially the exact same contracts for the exact same amounts that we had the service for the last 2 years.
Gotcha.
So. Do these two as rec, or do you want to wait till later?
No. Back to our recreation request. We received an email from Pat Chabarro.
Jonathan, Rich, the Brook Farm contract, is that one, I thought it was for 1 year.
It was for 1 year.
1 year, okay.
Yeah.
Great, all right. The Humane Society, 2 years.
Correct.
Okay.
That's why we have the resolutions, and we introduce the resolutions instead of just trying to.
Got it, okay.
Okay.
Sorry.
Yes.
I thought it was said there was a.
Recreation Department is putting out a survey on their website. If you have not received one, you're looking for feedback on how to better serve recreational activities to the town of Patterson. So if you have not received it yet, contact the Recreation Department and they will gladly send you a survey. It'll take you about 5 minutes. So, and they're looking for any and all information, again, to help all age groups in the town.
And this survey is up online, is it not?
Yes.
So they can go online.
PattersonRec.org.
Thank you.
Anything else, Charles?
No, I'm good.
Okay, first item we have on my agenda is a request for a reimbursement of building permit fees. And this was requested on behalf of Lorraine Forster, 51 Crossroad, for a solar panel installation. They have backed off that project. They're no longer going to complete the project. So our codes enforcement department has suggested a reimbursement minus the non-refundable application fee of $75. So the original amount was $281 minus the $75 application fee. They are requesting a reimbursement of $206 on that application. So I will make a motion that we refund $206 on that application. So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. And the next item, unfortunately, is a difficult situation that the town has been dealing with through our codes enforcement officer through a series of notice of violations on an unsafe house over in the Putnam Lake area at 40 Sanborn Road. And this has come to a point where the town believes they need to take an action to demolish or force the owners, the current owners, to demolish the house and remove the safety hazard. And so we have a number of documents that were supplied to the town board from the code enforcement officer relating to notices of violations and requests for certain actions to be taken. We have a resolution which would authorize the building inspector to take action to remediate the unsafe condition. And would like to move the resolution, but I'd like to open it up for any discussion also. So I guess that would happen upon a second.
A second.
So I will move the resolution authorizing the building inspector to take such action as necessary to remove the unsafe conditions at 40 Sanborn Road in Patterson, and introduce it as though it were read in its entirety into the record. So moved.
Second. Discussion?
The trigger here is that they have to take out a demolition permit and remove all structures by February 12th, 2017, correct?
Correct.
If it doesn't occur by that date, then we go in, do what we need to do, and then that becomes a levy on the property as far as taxes?
Yes.
Is that done by a private contractor, or are we sending?
Just one second.
What happens is if they don't comply, then the town obtains. Here, okay, probably the town obtains essentially a second opinion by way of a survey done by an architect to confirm the building inspector's opinion, and then the town can take the steps, and the town would contract with a private contractor to take those steps. All costs incurred, legal, architectural fees, contractors' fees, all become levies against the property.
And the owner's remedy is basically getting an injunction against the town prohibiting them from doing it if they feel that they're...
Correct. They received the notice and it's, and that's it, that's right.
Is that something that issues out of Supreme Court or can it issue in our local justice court?
I believe it's Supreme Court.
Supreme, okay.
Yep. We have to file a notice of pendency of action in the county as part of this, and that's being authorized by this.
I mean, we've been dealing with this a year, 2 years?
A year.
Well, I mean, proposed, the proposed remedy we've been dealing for.
Yeah, I have memos going back.
I know we've had discussions about the property a long time, but we actually talked about taking this action, I would say, about a year ago, and then it never came to fruition.
Sure.
Okay.
Now, before we can take any action, we need to have a public hearing on this. We need to set a date, which is also part of the resolution. So, next town board meeting?
Next town board meeting, yeah. We should do it.
So we can enter that into the resolution as the public hearing on this application will be held at the next town board meeting.
Okay.
So any member of the public who wants to be heard on the issue of whether the building is hazardous, not hazardous, should come to that meeting?
Correct.
Okay. All right.
The pictures supplied that I think everyone received copies of, even most recent inspections were pretty horrendous. Pictures of just floor joists sagging. I mean, the building is unsafe.
And yep.
I would hate to think that children in that neighborhood might get into that house and be hurt.
Is it secured now with a fence or anything around it?
I do not believe it's secured right now. But they are actively working on the house and cleaning out the contents.
Okay. All right.
And we had asked Bob McCarthy to give us an updated report because the last official notice and report had been, we thought, too old to form part of the record on the code enforcement matter,
okay.
Which he did.
Which is dated January 5th,
yep.
The most recent report, right?
That's it.
With the pictures. Okay.
Vote? You want to vote?
Anybody wants to move on without?
I'm ready to go. all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Unfortunately.
Unfortunately.
I think it's unfortunate that I think we have to take this action. But
okay.
No, I think we also have to protect the residents. Okay.
Okay. Within our town code and our zoning code, there is a provision in there that limits the number of commercial vehicles that a residential property can have on their property. It's been in existence for now 30 years, since at least the 1976 code. Recently, there's been an issue with a couple of property owners, and our code enforcement officer has sent us a memo asking for further clarification to be put within our zoning code as to what constitutes a commercial vehicle. And he's given us some suggestions here. I've taken a look at that. I can understand there is some hesitancy on his part. Things are not so cut and dried as they used to be many years ago. And what I'm doing is providing you all with a definition of what constitutes a commercial code according to the motor vehicle rules and regulations. I think that based on what I see here, we can tailor something within the zoning code, which kind of comports with what I provided you. But I wanted to open it up for any discussion, and I know there may be some people here that are interested in this topic. So
the scenario that gives rise to this is there's a person who has a Sprinter van and then has like a larger pickup truck, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so we can only have one commercial vehicle?
Currently within our code, you can only have one commercial vehicle, one ton, I believe it's one ton or less.
So the both plates have commercial plates, but the one would qualify for being just a regular vehicle. You'd get regular plates.
Be a 3/4 ton, which is not regulated.
Okay. Yeah, he talked about the scenario. I know it's concern to the people, but I mean, it does seem commercial plates versus commercial vehicle sometimes seem like they're two different things to me.
Sure. But I had a discussion earlier with one of the town board members where, you know, you could take a 3/4 ton pickup truck, and for all intents and purposes, that you know, is now considered more like a residential vehicle. There's so many of them on the road, even, you know, myself. You know, I drive a pickup truck. I don't think I've ever had a car in the past 30 years. But if I take that same truck and I put racks on it so that I can carry panes of glass, that no longer looks like a residential truck, a residential vehicle. So
what was the legislative intent of our code in adopting that? Like, what were we trying? Was it
Well, I can only assume what they were talking about in 1976 was to limit the number of commercial activities on a residential piece of property, because at some point it's no longer a residential piece of property. It looks more like
a business.
Commercial. A business, yeah.
I think a lot of times what comes to mind is people bring their commercial vehicles home and they bring home materials from jobs, and before you know it, their yard has a storage area where they keep, let's say they're a fencing contractor, and all of a sudden they're starting to store supplies alongside the residential property, and they bring vehicles home that have those tools and supplies. But this is a little more of an issue that you can kind of relate to, as you said, with I have a truck also, a pickup truck with a cap. Many years ago, if you had any pickup truck, it was always registered commercial. I had a Toyota pickup truck without a cap in college, and it was registered with commercial plates because it didn't have a cap. I wasn't a passenger. I guess they considered it a commercial vehicle. Couldn't drive it on the Taconic State Parkway.
No.
Right. None of
now
the
you can.
This is
you
the
know,
first truck I've ever had with combination plates.
Right. Yeah. So I think it, you know, certainly someone advertising a business on the side of their vehicle, I would think that doesn't necessarily make it commercial. You see smaller vehicles with business advertisements. I don't see how that in and of itself, it, you know.
Well, we have to be very careful when we're going down that road, because clearly signs put on the sides of the vehicles and lettering on the sides of the vehicles, the town is prevented from enforcing any codes on those vehicles. Correct me if I'm wrong, but
yeah,
you know, the Supreme Court has made a number of decisions. We can't regulate those signs.
Makes it easy.
Yeah.
That works.
So
what are we proposing as far as a new definition? Do you have?
So I can put it back on for next agenda if anybody has any further thoughts on it. But barring that, I'm going to take motor vehicles definition. I'm going to incorporate that into the zoning changes I am currently working on.
Okay. So it would be the definitions defined here, A, B, C. So animal, ambulance, armored truck, cab, and chassis. That's what you're talking about incorporating. Is that really going to help him, though?
Help who?
Bob, with this situation in terms of...
Well, I'm going to provide clarification as to what a commercial vehicle is. After that, Bob is going to have to take a look and see how it applies to any issues he has in front of him.
Okay.
And, you know, certainly I'm going to be working with Bob on a clear definition so he has a good understanding of what we're looking for.
Gotcha.
And not only him, but the residents.
Correct.
Okay. Even some of the definitions that you pulled, they're a little bit nebulous in the way that they're written.
Yeah. Okay, next on my agenda is the volunteer release and waiver. Don, have we moved anywhere on that?
I have not.
Okay, so next meeting, or?
Yeah.
Sir?
Yes, I still want to go
okay.
back to that
if,
one point.
If you're going to address the board, we need you to go to the mic and state your name for the record. And we're not picking on you, but we need, it's the only way we can get it on the camera.
That's right.
Hi, I'm Larry Martinez. I live at 541 East Branch Road. According to the state of New York, I want to clarify that a pickup truck with advertisements on it is definitely considered a commercial vehicle. That's in the definitions of the state of New York. The other thing I want to bring up to the fact is that anybody who has a lot as a flag lot and has property that sits in front of it, if there's a bunch of commercial vehicles parked in front, that takes away from what the property is behind it. So it makes it look like I'm a residential lot living behind the business, which takes away from my property's value, my curb appeal, et cetera, et cetera. So I want that to be clear also. So that's one of the reasons that those laws are in there, also to protect people, residents that pay their taxes to actually.
Can you go back to the first point that you made? Can you restate that?
About the pickup truck?
Yeah.
Sure. It says here, the pickup truck does not have any business advertisements, then it could be a non-commercial vehicle. Otherwise, it is considered a commercial vehicle.
Does it also say that a passenger vehicle, like a Molly, you see these maid services that have stickers Molly Maid, and would that be, in your opinion, a commercial vehicle also?
Yes.
I consider anything that has an advertisement.
That's an advertisement.
That has it on, especially when it's 100% of the time, is definitely a commercial vehicle.
I wonder about those vehicles that people seem to get as promotions, or they win them in some contest that have, you know, some advertisement on them. All these graphics that we see today on vehicles, I wonder if they're all considered commercial vehicles too. You brought up an interesting point.
I just say the town has to go by what the state of New York says a commercial vehicle is.
Yes.
That's all, you know, that's what I'm stating. Otherwise, it's unfair to just all of a sudden tell me that a commercial vehicle is not what the state of New York says. There are certain things that commercial vehicles have compared to regular passenger vehicles, where I have to pay for regular plates and do the regular thing.
Yeah.
So
not to put you on the spot, but is this issue occurring at a lot adjacent to your property?
That is correct.
So is the issue or your concern more aesthetic, or is it like noise and accessory uses to a commercial?
There's a lot more to it. Yes, there's the commercial vehicles actually block their own driveway.
Okay.
Which then has excessive use on my driveway.
So you share a driveway?
Right now we're in the process of debating that.
Okay. But I mean, the concern is the issue arising from the truck or accessory uses to the truck? Like,
it's both. I mean, both. I just don't like looking like I live behind a business. I think that's unfair to put that on me. I pay a lot of taxes. We just improved our property. So I think it's unfair to sit there and have people. I had family members ask me if I actually live behind a business. I said, I didn't know you lived behind a business. So.
What did you say your address is?
541 East Branch Road.
Say it again.
541 East Branch Road.
And you're a flag lot?
Yes.
But it sounds like regardless of commercial vehicles, you have issues that are relating to blocking access that are, whether they're commercial or not, it sounds like you...
That's irrelevant. With the commercial vehicles, I'm addressing...
Irrelevant to what we're considering, but certainly an issue you're still contending with, right?
Okay.
Right. Okay. Well, thanks for your comment.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming out.
Okay, last on my agenda are executive sessions for legal... both of them are legal, and I would like to add an additional executive session personnel. And I'll defer them to the end of the meeting.
Second.
All righty. First item on my agenda is conference requests. I believe we have one conference request that's been submitted, so I'll make a motion to approve that conference request as submitted. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Since Pete's not here, and I think this is an issue we probably want to discuss as an entire board, I'll defer again the New York State Open Meetings Law to my next meeting so we can have a discussion with all of us present.
Great.
So if you just carry it forward. Next item on my agenda are budget transfers. We have some closing out the 2016 calendar year and one for our first of 2017. So I'll make a first budget transfer request. 56 is within the Highway Department Traffic Control Contractual from Superintendent Highway Contractual for $155. Budget transfer request 57 is also within Highway from General Repairs Contractual to Machinery Contractual for $6,000. Budget transfer request 58 is within the Putnam Lake Lighting District, going from appropriated fund balance to street lighting contractual for $136. Budget transfer request 59 is within Patterson Fire Tax Certiorari. We're transferring $115 from workers' comp to judgments, claims, and tax certiorari. Budget transfer request 60 is within sanitation. It's moving $4,600 from transfer changes contractual to sanitation contractual. So actually, no, 61. Budget transfer 61 is between codes enforcement contractual. It's $789 between contingency account and codes enforcement contractual. This is basically us doing year-end adjustments of our budget, so everything, so we don't bounce any checks, basically. So I will make a motion to approve budget transfers 56 through 61, as read. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
And the first one of 2017 is a budget transfer request having to do with ambulance revenue, personal services, employee benefits, and contractual age. We are increasing the line of ambulance charges to the amount of $340,000. We are taking that from ambulance contractual, ambulance personnel services, employee benefits, retirement, employee benefits, social security, Medicare, workers' comp, unemployment, disability, and hospital and medical insurance. So basically, it's a move to increase the ambulance charge line to $340,000. So I will make a motion to approve budget transfer request number one of 2017 as read. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Being as Councilman Dan Uriano is not here, how about we just take one of his items and move it forward? Let's go first.
I'll go first. So the first item is fire department contract. We have a contract, I believe, with the Putnam Lake.
We have draft contracts being reviewed by both fire departments.
Both fire departments. Okay, so we have proposed fire contract, department contracts with both Putnam Lake and Patterson. We need to set a public hearing for those two items. So I'd ask the town clerk to advertise a public hearing. Is it going to be for the next board meeting?
That would be fine.
Good.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Do you want me to keep going? Or do you want me
next,
to...
we have a memo from our code enforcement officer regarding Front Street parking, and he's covering the fact that it's the parking in front of the cafe and the post office is very limited. The residents at 21 Front Street, 5 Center Street park in front of the cafe and post office, which limits the parking for customers. The area is limited to 1 hour parking. He's recommending long-term parking area be designated in front of 5 Front Street or the opposite side of the street along the railroad tracks where 20 spaces are available, and that there's parking passes available if we were to do that. I took a look at this these different locations, and 5 Front Street, for one thing, is a vacant lot.
Right. What he's referring to is there are 20 spaces on the opposite side of Front Street,
yes,
from the Bruno building that we negotiated an agreement with Metro North to lease.
Okay.
So we've got 20 spaces right there. We also have all down in front of Front Street where there are some vacant lots, but hopefully they're not going to stay vacant forever. But the discussion I had with Bob was looking at maybe designating those 20 as tenant parking spaces and issuing, and I've got to go back to the agreement because I think the agreement with Metro North says we can't actually issue permits for them, but we can designate them as tenant parking.
Yeah.
Yeah, and push the tenants down there so that there's more parking available to the businesses, especially the restaurant. Because, you know, I go down there at 6 o'clock in the morning.
There's 4 spaces in front of Reverie.
I've gone down at 6 o'clock in the morning. There are no spaces.
That's what I'm
in
saying.
Front of,
what I mean is
no,
there's only 4
oh,
spaces.
Oh, yeah, there's only
no
4 spaces.
There. Yeah.
But there's actually a lot more than 4 spaces, and it's all taken up by people living in that building. So that if you want to go to Reverie 6, 7 o'clock, you know, you've got to hike it.
Yeah.
So,
if we were to designate any or all parking spaces on the railroad side, we would have to, one, get Metro North's approval?
No.
For the first, not for
not
those
for the
20 spots.
Okay, those are ours to do with. We would have to post it that it's just for residents of these particular
I don't know
buildings
that we're
or streets.
Going to post it, or as we're issuing parking permits, because we have parking permits,
we're going to notify him that that's where the parking, you're going to be parking.
So then how do we enforce if there is a continuation of parking by residents in front of the post office and the cafe?
It's a one-hour parking area, so that was part of what the building inspector said, is if he sees people that are parked there for much more than an hour, that he's able then to take an enforcement, but right now it's difficult because there's no place designated for them.
And we're also going to know which cars we issue parking permits for.
They have window stickers or something. The only question that I have about the spots, and it's the only 20 we have available to work with, so you know, it is a little bit of a distance to those residences. You know, so the area that you mentioned in front of the vacant lot, is there a way that we can always revert to the 20 spots that we have? Is there a way to use some combination thereof if someone has some physical limitation? They're not handicapped spots, but certainly I would want to try to allow closer parking to a residence.
I think you run into the problem of those are on the public street. Mm-hmm. And if I remember right, you might have to get some kind of state authorization to designate public street parking for a select group.
To be handicapped accessible.
Well, not only that, but just that you could say, okay, residents in these buildings can park here, because you're saying that's the only ones who can park there. So I think there's...
Oh, I see what you mean.
So you have
now
to.
You're limited.
No, we don't, not for these 20 spaces, because...
No, he's talking about the ones that I was just bringing up on the opposite side.
On the other side,
that's all.
By the exercise place.
And honestly, you know, the big problem is the Bruno building, and he does have, I believe, adequate space on his site to provide parking on that site.
You mean additional parking? Parking
yeah.
that hasn't
yeah.
been constructed?
Yeah, you've got to remember, he had a big area there that was for a septic system. He's now in the sewer plant. Hmm. He doesn't have a septic system there anymore.
Okay.
So he certainly can provide on-site parking.
Well, that's a great, that is a great thing to keep on the back of your brain for if a change of use or some new use goes into that building. And that would be a good trigger with the planning board review to be able to then say
part
of site plan approval. But well, that, I think that's the time to do it, would be if there's a site plan trigger, you know. But
or if he wants to provide closer parking.
Yeah, right. He could always choose to do it, I'm saying.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
If we designate spots on across from the railroads, mm-hmm. okay, we have to be mindful of the Chinese restaurant and the exercise place.
That's true, but they have ample parking in front of that building.
Okay, I understand. So we wouldn't do that.
Let's not create a problem by trying to solve a problem. Is that
yeah,
what
sure.
you're saying?
Yeah. Right? So do you want to, you know, take a couple of weeks, take a look at this? Think about it for a while. We'll put it on for the next agenda.
Yeah, I mean,
does
I think,
he? Go ahead. I'm sorry.
Did they work with Bob on which is the best spaces? I mean, we should get a handle on how many cars are we talking about,
and start issuing them closer to the residences,
yeah.
which would be further away from the
and
businesses.
And we got to work. Also, take into consideration where the frame shop.
No good deed goes unpunished. I'm sure there'll be some reason this won't work, but let's try to make it better.
The frame shop has parking not only behind the building, but ample parking in front of the building.
Yeah.
And we're not talking about covering any of those spaces.
Okay.
Yep. Okay, all right. So what motion do we need to effectuate some progression on this?
I don't think anything right now. It's just, you know, we put it on the agenda so you're aware of the issue. You can take a look at it.
Okay.
Bring it up for the discussion at next meeting.
Sure.
Okay, next. Like me to do this?
I could. Want me to do it?
Go ahead.
Okay, the next item on Councilman D'Andriano's agenda is EMS Administrator. As many of you know, the town had solicited qualified applicants to apply for the EMS, I don't want to call it the wrong thing, emergency medical service administrator position to oversee and supervise the town-sponsored ambulance service. We got some pile of applicants, didn't we?
Probably had close to 20 applicants.
20 applicants.
Yeah.
We ended up interviewing six people, really highly qualified candidates. And the town board is happy to say that we have a resolution to appoint Denise Montana as the person selected to be the first Patterson Emergency Medical Services Administrator. So I will move that we introduce this resolution as though it were read in its entirety into the record. So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Well deserved.
Good luck. Last on the
agenda.
God bless. Last on the agenda is we have a vacancy on the Putnam Lake Park Advisory Board. And I would like to defer this to after our executive session because the candidate is here. And we would like to interview them, get to know them a little bit better before we make any appointments. We do have a recommendation from the Putnam Lake Park Advisory Board as well, a glowing recommendation. So we'll defer that.
Glowing.
So, that being taken care of, Councilman Dandriano's agenda, does any councilman have any other business?
I think we have the announcement from Mary. Should we?
Yeah. Yes.
Should I read that?
Yep.
Please.
This is just an announcement with regards to collecting taxes. The tax collector, now I have the wrong one. For the convenience of town residents, tax receiver Mary Delanoy will be collecting taxes Saturday, January 21st at the Patterson Town Hall from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. and on Saturday, January 28th at the Putnam Lake Firehouse, also from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. So bring your checks or bags of cash to Mary on those days, and we'll happily accept your funds through Mary. So thank you.
Anyone else?
I think everybody in town knows that, Mary, you have a way of doing your job that people come in and they're smiling when they leave, and that's rare with people with giving over the taxes. And so I think you should be commended for the way in which you do your job. Very well appreciated. And Sally did an amazing job also, so thank you for carrying on with that.
Thank you for taking all money with a smile.
I have one more issue. Last year we had applied for a grant. For many years now, the town has been scanning our documents into a format which is searchable and retrievable, and so that we have all our documents in an electronic database. One of the things we have not been able to do is scan larger plans coming into the building department and the planning board. We have been consistently searching for money through grants to buy a scanner so that we can take on that task as well and get all our records into an electronic format. Last year we had applied for a grant. We were not successful, and Mary in the planning department, Mary Chartreau, has once again prepared a grant application for us to submit to the Local Government Records Management Improvement Fund. And I would like to move that the town board acknowledges submission of this grant application in the amount of $10,230. So moved.
Second.
Discussion. You said the amount was $10,000.
Yeah, I thought that's what it was.
And that's the amount that we're seeking through the grant to buy the equipment?
I believe so.
Okay.
Well, this says $17,000.
$17,000. I only picked up the copier. $17,350, you're right.
Okay, I see it.
That's the number that's right above my signature.
And is there any potential for sharing with other municipalities? If someone had to, you know, I'm thinking in terms of, would that make the grant application more
palatable?
Favorable?
Favorable.
Yes, absolutely. And they are looking to do sharing on these kinds of projects with other municipalities.
the problem we have is the piece of equipment is fairly cumbersome.
Well, I wouldn't mean moving the equipment. I mean, you have somebody come over with a pile of plans once a quarter or once a week.
And we certainly could do that, but I think with the volume of plans that we currently have here that we need to get scanned in, you know, the other part of this application is seeking an intern to actually scan some of the plans in. So at least initially, I think we need to, you know, focus on what we're doing in Patterson. I will tell you, though, that last year we lost out on this grant application because the county found a partner. I was competing with the county, and they partnered with Cold Springs, so that Cold Springs is doing just that. They're bringing their plans into the county.
Okay.
County has a lot more personnel that they can, you know, take on something like this. But, you know, we're gonna try it this way again.
Okay. I think this is great.
Hopefully we'll be more successful.
I think it's great. But yeah. Now, could we piggyback on the county's equipment the same way?
Well, again, the county has an incredible volume of plans that...
we'd be on a waiting list forever.
And I certainly had the conversation with the county clerk.
Okay.
You know, last year about participating. And based on their volume and our volume, I wasn't sure that, you know, it was going to be successful.
Right.
We would be sitting there on a long waiting list, waiting to get access.
What about advising our state senator and assemblyman that this grant is going forward and...
Sure, I could certainly send them an email.
I mean, just...
Yeah, no, okay. I'm constantly having conversations with our state assemblyman and state senator about, you know, various issues before the town and bring this up.
Yeah.
Sure.
They
great.
Support it, and mm-hmm. maybe it'll help.
Anyone else? Public recognition? Hi.
Hi. Just wanted to check. We had, at the last meeting, we spoke about inviting somebody from the health department possibly to be attending our committee meetings.
Could you state your name?
I'm sorry, Peggy Boyle, Sapling Court.
Thank you. Yes, I did.
Okay.
After the last meeting, send a letter over to Director of Environmental Services. Is that his title? Rob Morris. I have not received the response.
Okay.
I also have a draft that I've been working with the person we selected to do the testing to mm-hmm. make sure we get the protocol right.
So I was going to ask you that
to get that letter out.
That had started.
I was hoping to have it all done last week, but
okay.
unfortunately, trying to resolve some of the lawsuits that we have pending right now,
okay.
Specific with Patterson Crossing, is
okay. The other thing, and I don't even know if it's feasible, what about, like, I was thinking today, I guess I read something in a paper, like our soil and water for Putnam County, like anybody from there being on? I mean, I'm just going by what Mr. Winkley had put in his letter as far as, you know, having other people, you know, attend or be on this committee.
Lori's still with the county?
Lori Taylor?
Yeah.
Yes.
Listen, I could reach out to Lori.
Okay.
Unfortunately, you know, she has been moved more from Putnam County Planning over to Highway.
Okay.
So she's functioning more in some highway capacity, I think. I don't know.
Or maybe
but
just her office was over there. I don't know. Yeah, I know Lori, too. I mean, you know, I could, you know, but you can reach out. Okay.
Sure.
All right, good. Just wanted to check.
Okay.
There may be someone within the planning department who might be more appropriate. You don't know what the
I could also
job
reach out to
functions are.
Barroso? County planner?
Sandy Fusco is the new commissioner, isn't she?
True.
Deputy commissioner.
I can reach out to Sandra. Hi.
Hi. Jennifer Gallagher, also Sapling Court. I just want to give you a little update. You know that the New York State Health Department had come out and tested,
mm-hmm.
you know, three of the homes. Unfortunately, they contacted me. I spoke to them on Tuesday, and I failed lead miserably.
Lead.
Lead.
Did they?
In a big, yeah, 33 micrograms.
Did you hear any reason why?
Their suspicion is that because, well, Peggy had the plumbing redone in her home, so she has like the Plex
PVC.
Pipe. Yeah.
And also my pipe going from the well to my home.
Come forward.
I had a pipe break.
several years ago. And that pipe was replaced also with PVC plastic, whatever they use, I don't know. So that was from the well to my home. And because of that and having construction work done inside, I also changed almost all the piping in my house. So there's like plexi. I don't have the original, you know, the pipes or anything there anymore. So I can't think of any other reason why she would have lead. I don't.
Their suspicion is that because the water is such a high level of sodium and chloride, much like what happened in Flint, Michigan, it leaches the lead out of the pipes from my plumbing in my home, obviously then contaminating the water at a pretty miserable level.
So to be clear, you do have copper pipes, do you not?
They're metal. I mean, but it was not apparently, the house is probably the 70s?
40 years old.
Yeah.
42 years old.
So they said, even if it's copper pipes, because my water is so corrosive, there's lead present even in other types of metals. So it will leach lead out of copper because lead is so soft. This is what I've been told. So I was in touch with the Putnam County Health Department today. Actually, they came out to do some more testing at my home this morning. And my family, and including my dog, all have to go and have blood tests done to see what the level of actual exposure in our bloodstream is at this rate. So it's kind of gone from like 0 to 60 for us, as far as the situation, way past the sodium and chloride now for us with the lead contamination. Just wanted to.
How long did they say till they get the results of your blood levels?
The blood level, apparently they can't see us until the 17th.
Oh, okay.
But originally they, you know, had told us that we had to go, you know, through our family doctor. I spoke to my family doctor and they were like, no, the health department has to, you know, do that. Called them back, had that just conversation with them. And they said, okay, we'll do it. We typically don't do it for adults, only children. I guess they have a machine, my doctor said, and the health department, that will give me those levels within like 5 minutes.
Okay.
So if there's any even suspicion of exposure, then it requires blood testing from, you know, a venipuncture to do like a further panel. The problem being is, you know, they're not really sure how much is absorbed through the skin, but because of my autoimmune conditions and my skin is open, it's a really, really serious issue for me. And so some of the health problems that I've been having could very much be a result of this, the lead exposure. So I just wanted to let council know, everyone in the community know, if you have an older home, if you suspect that you might be having a sodium and chloride issue, and we know that it's an issue here in town, get a lead test, because it could be deadly.
Thank you.
Eleanor Smith, President, Patterson Fire Department. I just want clarification on the public hearing for the contracts.
Correct.
You're saying you're going to have the public hearing next meeting?
Yes.
Now, you can have a public hearing without the contracts being signed and negotiated?
We have to have a public hearing before the contracts are signed, yes.
Okay, then we discuss it, and then we'll...
Sure, anytime you're ready.
Yeah, because there's things in there, including EMS, that... we don't have any money for it, but you put in the contract and we have nothing about it.
The EMS should have come out.
It's still in there.
Okay.
Supplemental assistance, it says. But there's been no conversation at all. Okay.
Okay.
Want that on public record.
Okay. Anyone else? Motion to go into executive session?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you all for coming.